Yes, you read that correctly. The infamous Aleister Crowley once attended John Nelson Darby's church as a youngster as his parents were a part of the Plymouth Brethren group. Crowley later in life called himself the Great Beast, 666. How did he get so messed up? Well, anyone accepting John Nelson Darby's teachings is going to be messed up, at least when it comes to Bible prophecy. The Jesuit prophecy baton was passed on to Darby after Edward Irving faded from the scene. Darby was so intrigued with visionary Margaret MacDonald from Irving's church that he even visited her home. Her revelation consisted of a return of Jesus that could not be seen with the natural eye, but only by enlightened Christians. I would like to quote a section of her utterance here. Notice how she emphasizes that Jesus won't be seen with the natural eye, but only seen spiritually.
Now look out for the sign of the Son of Man. Here I was made to stop and cry out. Oh, it is not known what the sign of the Son of Man is. The people of God think they are waiting, but they know not what it is. I felt this needed to be revealed, and that there was great darkness and error about it, but suddenly it was burst upon me with a glorious light. I saw it was just the Lord himself descending from heaven with a shout. Just the glorified man, even Jesus.
But that all must, as Stephen was, be filled with the Holy Ghost,
that they might look up, and see the brightness of the Father's glory. I saw the error to be that men think that it will be something seen by the natural eye.
Stop right there, Margaret. Listen to what the Bible says.
Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen.
But 'tis spiritual discernment that is needed, the eye of God in his people. Many passages were revealed in a light in which I had not before seen them. I repeated, now is the kingdom of heaven like unto 10 virgins, who went forth to meet the bridegroom, 5 wise and 5 foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps, but took no oil with them.
But they that were wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps.
But be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is, and be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. This was the oil the wise virgins took in their vessels. This is the light to be kept burning, the light of God, that we may discern that which cometh not with observation to the natural eye.
Wait a minute, Margaret, the Bible says in Psalm chapter 119.
Only those who have the light of God within him will see the sign of his appearance. No need to follow them who say, see here, or see there, for his day shall be as the lightning to those in whom the living Christ is. 'Tis Christ in us that will lift us up. He is the light, 'tis only those that are alive in him that will be caught up to meet him in the air. I saw that we must be in the Spirit, that we might see spiritual things.
If you examine Margaret's utterance closely, you will notice that she is proclaiming that there will be an invisible return of Christ that only enlightened people can see. She keeps talking about having a light that will show us and that this light burst upon her. She teaches that discernment comes by this light. But the Bible says that God's word is our light. Discernment based upon some mysterious experience is not how Christians should discern. Jesus does not come alone as she states. In several passages it says Jesus comes with his angels and other passages even mention that he comes with the saints. New Ages also promote a Jesus that comes in a spiritual sense but not in the flesh. Dear friends, 1 John chapter 4 says, "Do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world." This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God, but every spirit that does not acknowledge that Jesus came in the flesh is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming and even now is already in the world.
Margaret's pastor, Edward Irving, failed miserably to teach his people to discern. Newspaper articles from his era document that Irving's church services were chaotic and disorderly. Even Darby said, and I quote,
"No doubt the devil has been thus working among Mormonites and Irvingites."
Yet Darby trots right over to Margaret's house and stays for 3 days because he was so intrigued by her utterance. Dispensationalists now try to distance Darby from Margaret, claiming that he did not receive his revelation of a pre-tribulation rapture from Margaret, but came up with it on his own, years prior. Even so, he did show quite the enthusiasm for Margaret's proclamation even after knowing devils were operating in Irving's church. Let's find out more about what was going on at Irving's church. Let's meet Margaret's very close friend, Mary Campbell.
In 1830, a woman by the name of Mary Campbell claimed that she had received the gift of tongues. Not only that, she also wrote these languages on paper, even though she had no idea what she was writing. We're going to be talking about Mary Campbell on this episode. And one of these sects was a group led by a woman in 1830 by the name of Mary Campbell, a woman that would later be associated with the Reverend Edward Irving. The story goes like this, that while on her sickbed, Mary Campbell miraculously recovered by way of a prophetic miracle. After that, she vowed to spend the rest of her life converting the heathen. Through promptings and impressions, she concluded that this was God calling her to the mission field. But rather than study a foreign language, Campbell believed that all she needed to do was pray and God would miraculously bestow the ability to speak the languages, and thus she allegedly received the gift of tongues. She began writing strange-looking characters on paper that neither she nor any of her followers could decipher. And even though no one knew what kind of languages the characters were supposed to be, everyone, including Mary, was convinced that, well, it was some sort of language from some heathen tribe somewhere in the world. Now, this should sound very familiar to you if you've watched any of my previous videos on Parham. In 1901, Agnes Osman, the first to claim the gift of tongues in Parham's group, also wrote characters on paper, claiming that they were Chinese. Of course, it was proven that they weren't Chinese. It was also proven that the characters Mary wrote were not languages either. This did not deter Mary, however, because it wasn't long before her group started performing healing miracles, and soon it was publicly announced that the apostolic gift of healing was restored to the church. Edward Irving even invited Mary Campbell to London and pronounced that the apostolic gifts had returned. So we're looking at a portion of an article here from newspapers.com. From the Standard, the London Greater England, May 28, 1830. And I'm going to look at this portion right here, because this is what mentions her tongues and writings. This is a very long article, so there's no way we're going to read the entire thing. This is what it says. "However, this may be, she was, or at all events, imagined herself endowed with," look here, "the gift of tongues, which gift consisted in uttering certain articulate sounds without any meaning attached to them, but which were supposed to be a language, and informing on paper," here it is right here, "informing on paper certain marks which were supposed to be either words or letters. And as every time she opened her mouth or put her pen to paper, the sounds or marks were different. The languages were, of course, different, and her acquirements are now so numerous that she possesses more languages than Sir William Jones ever did, with the trifling difference that he understood his." And then it goes on to speak of another girl who thought she had also received the gift of tongues and was speaking in French, And of course, her pastor convinced her that it wasn't true because he spoke the language and he could tell that all she was doing was speaking gibberish. I want to move down to this section right here. Bottom section here of the article. Every word she uttered was taken down. She herself committed them to writing and wrote out the characters, and she was flocked to from all quarters. Her prophecies, her visions were listened to as oracular, and she prayed fervently in the unknown tongue, or, as it has been well termed by some of the learned men to whom it has been submitted, in the language of gibberish. Okay, we are now at the Aberdeen Journal and General Advertiser for the North of Scotland. This is a year later, June 22nd, 1831. This is where Mary Campbell meets Edward Irving. The gift of prophecy and tongues. The celebrated Mary Campbell and her husband have arrived in London and are now residing with the Reverend Edward Irving. This lady has, it seems, the gift of prophecy and tongues. But unfortunately, neither she herself nor anyone else can interpret or understand the language which she speaks. Now watch the reason why. The reason of which is said to be that the gift of tongues has been given, but look at this, not as yet the gift of interpretation. So you have tongues, but God hasn't quite given the entire thing yet because he hasn't given the gift of interpretation, right? We are of opinion that another gift is much wanted in the same quarter, that is, the very rare gift of common sense. Be this as it may, Mary Campbell and her husband, as well as the rest of the prophets, are of opinion that they have a commission to preach the gospel to a certain people as yet unknown who speak the languages with which they are miraculously gifted. So once again, they've got the gift, but they don't know who they're going to be reaching because they're not sure which language they're speaking.
I suppose I can understand why the dispensationalists want to distance their founder from these strange people. So, let's grant that perhaps Darby just had a strange fascination with Margaret MacDonald and leave it at that. Perhaps he got his revelations earlier in life. Let's go find out where he grew up. I hope you are sitting down for this one. His family just happened to own what's known as the most haunted castle in Ireland and perhaps the most haunted castle in Europe. This castle had been in the Darby family since 1649, all the way up until the late 1800s. Now here comes the weird part. John Nelson had a brother whose wife was heavily involved in the occult. Her name was Mildred. She held seances at the mansion. She often reported seeing spirits wander around the house and she engaged in what's called automatic writing. In the occult world, automatic writing happens when a spirit speaks to a person through writing. It gets worse.
Lepp Castle is Ireland's most haunted castle. Some say it's even Europe's most haunted castle. It was built in the early 1500s by the O'Bannon clan, secondary chieftains under the ruling O'Carroll clan. The castle was used to guard the Slieve Blue Mountains. The castle was built on the site where druids had initiation ceremonies. The castle is known for its bloody past, from the murder of a priest by his brother in the bloody chapel to the poisoning of 30 members of the MacMahon clan. But in today's video, we explore one of its most notorious hauntings, the Elemental. The origin of the Elemental is unknown, but many believe it was the result of druid magic. Mildred Darby, a previous resident of the castle, dabbled in the occult. Her activities focused on seance and automatic writing. Some believe it was Mildred who awoke the Elemental. It was around the time that three cartloads of skeletons were discovered in the oubliette, approximately 150 bodies, that Mildred Darby encountered the Elemental, and she wrote a description of her terrifying encounter.
I will spare you the rest of that video so you can sleep at night. I encourage you to go read about the Darby family history. I can firmly say that Darby does not have any sort of Christian heritage whatsoever. I wonder what it was like growing up in an environment like that. Now let's hear an excerpt from John Nelson Darby's biography written by Max Weremchuk.
Years ago, during my research for the revision of my biography on John Nelson Darby, I was happy to have made contact with a person from the exclusive wing of the Brethren who was very helpful in supplying me with information not readily heard otherwise. During one exchange concerning Leap Castle, he said, "Now, I want to tell you a story my late father told me." He said that John Nelson Darby was staying at a very old house and was resting, but awake. In bed, when he was suddenly aware of a presence in the room, a hooded man, who indicated silently, by pointing, that he wanted something out of a drawer or cabinet in the corner. Darby responded by saying words to the effect, "Take what you want," and the spirit then went and opened the said drawer, or similar, and removed some item. Having turned to acknowledge Darby, the figure then vanished, no sound having been made, and Darby had no rational explanation for the event. Then my late father, who as an exclusive brother professed no belief at all in ghosts, but did think there was some possibility of visible, evil spirits, which might be visible at times. And I have no idea from where or whom my father heard the story, and yet I do not believe he would pass on something about someone he revered such as John Darby, which he thought was untrue. Yet I have never heard the tale from anyone else. It does occur to me that Leap Castle would be one possible place for such an event to have occurred. It is alleged repeatedly that various monk-like, ghostly figures have been seen there over the centuries.
I guess compared to this, the incident with Margaret MacDonald seems quite mild. So in conclusion, this man, John Nelson Darby, is considered the father of dispensationalism. During the time John Darby appeared on the religious scene, so did many other cult leaders such as Joseph Smith, who created Mormonism, Charles Taze Russell that invented the Jehovah's Witnesses, and William Miller of the Adventist movement. Also, these false prophets made a flurry of false dates for the Lord's return. William Miller predicted that Jesus would return in 1843. Edward Irving said Jesus would return in 1864.
The founder of the Jehovah's Witnesses said Jesus would return in 1874.
And when that didn't happen, he said that it was an invisible return of Jesus. Doesn't that sound like the same kind of idea Margaret was preaching when she said that people would not see Jesus with the natural eye? New Agers teach this sort of thing today. They teach that Jesus will return in some sort of spiritualized way and not really physically. Listen to this New Age man named Michael ramble on about the rapture and you will see what I mean.
We are being raptured. God has selected us. He's pulling us out of the matrix because we're here for the event, and we're able to serve. We'll be able to bring forth the new earth once we exit the matrix. You see, there is a divine plan, and I know right now it might seem very scary, and many people are being raptured out of the matrix right now, but this is because God has selected us, and we're selected to bring forth the victory of the light.